All rise, the judge is here. Here today, the court of appeals to hear the case of Bartholomew and Marjorie. The appellants have answered the jury arguments, please.
May it please your ladyship, my name is Sheena Ramakrishnan, senior counsel on behalf of the appellants Bartholomew. I appear in this case with my learned friend Anastasia Matubi, junior counsel. Appearing on behalf of the respondents are my learned friends Ray Andrews, senior counsel, and Jake Wolfen, junior counsel. The facts of the case can be found under tab A of the appellate by bill of authorities. Would my lordship like to remind her of the facts?
That's all right, thank you.
I am obliged, my lady, the facts are stated here. My lady, in the instant case, there are two grounds of appeal. Firstly, on the grounds of foreseeability, that it was reasonably foreseeable that Hamilton would return home from work drunk, which would in turn involve significant risk of harm to Bartholomew. Secondly, Marjorie and Bartholomew had a special relationship as mother and son, entitling Bartholomew to rely on affirmative actions by Marjorie. And as such, it would be fair, just, and reasonable to require Marjorie to demonstrate the duty of care to the standard of reasonable hearing judged by the standards of the day. My lady, I shall be dealing with the first round, and my learned junior counsel will be dealing with the second round of appeal. My lady, may I proceed with my first submission, which concerns the case of Wagaman Wong?
Yes, ma'am.
If my ladyship could open the booklet submitted, my lady should have sight of the public skeleton argument found on page 1.
Mm-hmm.
Does my ladyship have sight?
Mm-hmm.
My ladyship, in relation to the first round of appeal, I have four submissions to make. First, if I may now refer my lady to the case of Bolton versus Stone, 1951. Facts and principles which can be found in section 3, tab 1. Would my ladyship like a brief summary of the case?
Yes, please.
In this case, the individuals were playing cricket at the cricket ground, where individual X hit the ball, it flew over the rather high wall, and hit the pedestrian, C, injuring him. C sued individual S, the trustees of the field, for compensation. I would now like to refer to what was held by Lord Porter, which can be found in section 8, tabs A1. In this case, Lord Porter referred to what Lord Atkin described in the case of Donahue versus Stevenson, where Lord Atkin stated that you must take reasonable care to avoid acts or omissions which you can reasonably foresee would be likely to injure your neighbor. So, just because one can foresee a risk does not mean one is obliged to guard against that risk. Only if it is reasonably foreseeable that injury would occur, most likely one would be asked to guard against it. If the risk is so small, then one is not obliged to do anything. In the case before us, the risk of abuse against Bartholomew was not small. And as such, Marjorie should have foreseen the danger to her son and taken steps to guard against such risks, which she failed to execute. I would now like to refer to what was held by Lord Norman in the same set case, which can be found in section 8, tab 2. The leadership outside. Lord Norman in the set case stated that, but it is necessary to consider the measures of the duty and what is considered reasonably foreseeable, one should pay close importance to the qualification of reasonable. So it is not the law that precautions can be taken against every peril. A person is bound to foresee only the reasonable and probable consequences, and failure to take care, which is judged by the standard of the reasonable man. Again, in the present case, an ordinary reasonable man can't foresee such an act of abuse upon Bartholomew by Homerton. Any person, reasonably enough, can deduce such harm from simply looking at past situations, in which it is clearly stated that Homerton was an abusive husband. I would now like to refer to what was held by Lord Reed, which can be found in section 8, tab 8.3, in the set case. Let's see here. In this case, Lord reheld that people must guard against reasonable probabilities, but they are not bound to guard against fanatic probabilities. So, in this, one could summarize from what Lord Reed said that individuals must guard against reasonable probabilities. The test to be applied here is whether the risk of damage to a person on the road, which the setting talks about, on the road was so small. So a reasonable man in the position of the appellants would have thought it right to refrain from taking steps to prevent danger. The risk of danger to Bartholomew was so big that a reasonable man in Marjorie's situation should have taken steps to prevent such a harm on Bartholomew. My second submission.
So this is where you want to go. I'm just checking for you. You seem to be making out that it's reasonably foreseeable that Hamilton returns home and attacks the child, but you suggest as well you might find that that's a first incident.
No, you said it wasn't reasonably foreseeable.
Yeah, that's right. So you're looking for the facts if you're found, not just the law. You're looking for the facts if you're found, not just the law. You're looking for the facts if you're So, in your next submission, can you think about facts in the first report?
My second submission is with regards to the case of Biden on 1. First, if I may now permanent tab A of bundle under tab A 1, highlighted in blue, is the case of Biden on 1. With my ladyship, like brief summary of the case.
Perhaps the court would like to come in.
Summary of facts. In this case, the defendant had negligently spilled oil into the water from the ship, which spread out among the harbor. After leaving with no attempt to do anything, some welders on the quay were welding. A spark ignited amongst the cotton waste that was floating in the water, got in contact with the oil, which in turn ignited the oil and caused considerable damage to the equipment in the water. My lady, it is counsel's argument in said case that can be seen by referring to this counsel's statement in Wagner 1, where your ladyship could find in section C under the yellow tab highlighted. This consonance pointed out that if it is asked why a man should be responsible for the natural and necessary or probable consequences of his act, the answer is that it is not because they are natural or necessary or probable, but because, since they have this quality, it is judged by the standard of the reasonable man that the cause have to see them, and as much in the case set out before us. The test for liability for Bartholomew's injury is for foreseeability of injury by abuse. As long as the damage is a kind that was foreseeable, the defendant would be liable for the full extent of the damage. In the present case, foreseeability of harm towards Bartholomew is clearly foreseeable, due to the fact that Homerton would frequently return home from work drunk, and had a number of occasions verbally and physically assaulted Marjorie. From this point, any reasonable man can perceive that such abuse towards his wife can also be directed against the child. My lady, counsel argues that in the interest of Bartholomew's mutual well-being, I urge that the report should be admitted. My third submission is with regards to the case of Hughes versus Lord Advocate of 1963. With my lady Linda Summer. My lady is counsel's argument in the said case can be seen by referring to Lord Morris. His judgment can be found under section D on the yellow tab and his words highlighted in blue.
So would you like to try that one again?
It is in section B under the yellow tab.
Mm-hmm. I think it's section B. That's John on the second.
Section 1, 2, 3.
Or this versus for that case.
What page do you want to refer to in this case? What is the page reference you're having on
the
have a question over here. Is it clear?
Hold on.
In this case, Lord Morris stated that part of his lamb could always be seen as a dangerous object. In this case, the defendant could reach a piece of care by not putting any precautions to protect the children against such danger. And in relation to the case of Morris, Marjorie breached her duty of care in terms of not being there to protect her son, knowing fully well that her husband's dwelling and risk of harm to Bartholomew is ever present. Secondly, if I may now refer my lord to tab D of the Bible under the yellow tab, highlighted in blue, his lord's reading. Where
it's not
past
it, Cameron.
Where he stated that it was reasonably foreseeable that children may come by and play. And the fact that the lamb acted in an unpredictable way does not mean that the defendant can escape liability. In this case, it was reasonably foreseeable that Hamilton would act in an abusive manner to his Bartholomew in the absence of Marjorie. Thus, Marjorie must pay damages for all the extent of reasonably foreseeable damages that result. The extent of the damages need not be reasonably foreseeable. My fourth submission is regards to the case of Jolly versus Sutton, with my ladyship like briefs on your case. In this case, the Jolly was 14, and a few of his friends, and along with him, attempted to repair a rotten exposed bolt left in some wasteland by council. While repairing it, the bolt toppled over and fell on Jolly, breaking his back and causing paraplegia. The judge found against council. The Court of Appeal reversed the decision. My lady, it's counsel's argument in said case can be seen by referring to Lord Stang's statement, which can be referred to in the bundle or the second C. I'd like to give you the yellow tab. Lord Stang stated that neither the Guatemala nor Hughes versus Lord Advocate have dealt in the idea that if damage is reasonably foreseeable, that X is responsible for the totality of the reasonably foreseeable damage caused. Owing to circumstances, the inquisitive nature of children, and the fact that the boat could have been easily moved, and the council said was under the duty to remove it, simply it was foreseeable that small children played on the structure and suffered minor injuries. Was it foreseeable that Humberton would eventually abuse Bartholomew and thus cause physical injury? Yes, it was. And as such, the court has to judge the nature of the risk, which ought to be perceived, which in this case is clear. In conclusion, my ladyship, I meticulously selected four cases, with very similar principles to the circumstances of the case the court has before today. The court would kindly apply the same principle to Bartholomew's circumstance, because they are similar, if not identical, principles in some areas. It would be harsh to not compensate him for the negligence of his mother. Bartholomew should be given his rightful justice. Therefore, I would like to respectfully ask the court to allow the appeal.
The case you mentioned is somewhat dated, exceptionally joyous. It's so much more up-to-date case that you could have used, which is more in fact to the scenario you have in front of you.
It pleases your ladyship. I, Rachel Andrews, are here with my learned friend, Jane Oakland, for the respondent. I will begin by submitting arguments for the respondent, Marjorie, based on the first ground. The skeleton argument can be found on yellow tab 0. If it pleases the court, I would like to offer my first submission. Much obliged, my lady. My lady, I submit that it was not reasonably foreseeable for Marjorie to consider that Bartholomew would come to harm at the hands of Hamilton. My lady, to reference the case of Papara Indictment in 1990, second volume, Appeal Court, page 605, found on orange tab 1. Would my lady have said? Much obliged. Would my lady benefit from a brief summary of the facts of the case?
Please
carry on. I would like. My lady, the facts are set out in the opinion of Lord Bridge of Harwich. No duty of care was owed to the Papara as a potential acquirer of shares because of lack of proximity. End quote. My lady, it is clear from the facts that in the first instance of the case we have in hand today, they failed the Kapara test, and thus this decision should be upheld. In application, again we can see that, because of lack of proximity between Marjorie and Bartholomew, no duty of care from Marjorie to Bartholomew existed at the time of the event. My lady, I would like now to draw the attention of the court to the case of Surrey County Council M. 2001, England and Wales, Court of Appeal, Civil Division, page 691, found in the pink tab 2. Is my lady myself?
Indeed. Mm-hmm.
Much obliged. Would my lady benefit from a brief summary of the facts of the case?
Yes, indeed.
M, age 5 at the time, had alleged that the local authority owed her a duty of care, and they had been reasonably foreseeable that K, a boy of age 13, would have been charged in the past with serious sexual offences and his family had been moved across the street from M with sexual assault rape. It was held a claim had no reasonable prospects of success due to the lack of proximity. In other words, it failed the Kapara test. My lady, in the case of Surrey County Council and M, 2001, England and Wales, Court of Appeal, Civil Division, page 691, Sir Martin North held that foreseeability and proximity remain threshold requirements for any duty of care. It is seen, therefore, that although there is proximity and that it was between a mother and son, there was no geographical proximity between Marjorie and Bartholomew. Thus, no duty of care would have existed at the time. My lady, in the case of Surrey County Council and M.
Part of the geographical proximity is exactly what there would be in contrast to the case that we're putting forward just now. They're sitting in the same
house as Banfield, geographically. I apologise, my lady. I took the fact that Marjorie was actually bonding
at that particular moment.
My lady, in the case of Surrey County Council and M, 2001, England, Wales, Court of Appeal, Civil Division, page 691, the appellants were cleared from a conviction for failing to notice that a child would be abused. Lord Justice Mans held that he, the child, was not in their, the council's care. They had no power to move him elsewhere. Furthermore, as the father had not been convicted of any offences or the material times and bail, the council did not think that he would re-offend. Thus, the court held that there was no foreseeability on the council's behalf for any harm that became the child, and their claim failed on proximity. In application, it would be argued that Margie would not be able to reasonably foresee any danger for the child, as unlike the reference case, the father in concern, Homerton, had not been convicted previously. It would be unforeseeable that any danger would arise to Bartholomew by his father. In summary, due to the lack of geographical proximity at the time, Margaret could not have reasonably foreseen these events. That concludes my first submission. My lady, if it pleases the court, I would now like to continue with my second submission. I'm obliged, madam. My second submission, I submit that Marjorie perceived the relationship between Homerton and Bartholomew to be a healthy one, and thus could not have reasonably foreseen the events in the result. My lady, from the fact it is evident that Homerton would bring home food and eat with Bartholomew every Thursday. It is clear from the fact that this was routine, thus because Marjorie consistently left Homerton alone every Thursday, it is clear that from Marjorie's perspective, Homerton and Bartholomew had a healthy relationship. So why would Marjorie have reasonable cause to believe that Bartholomew is in danger? My lady, although there have been occasions where Homerton has come home under the influence of alcohol and verbally and physically assaulted Marjorie, there is no evidence to suggest that Homerton has ever verbally or physically assaulted Bartholomew. Thus, what reason would Marjorie have to reasonably perceive Homerton's actions towards Bartholomew? My lady, I would like to draw your attention to the court case of Smith and Littlewoods, 1987, Volume 1, Appeal Court, page 241. This can be found on page tab 3. Much obliged. Would my lady benefit from a brief summary of the facts?
Yes,
I am obliged. It was held that the appeal was dismissed since the defendants had not known of the previous acts of vandalism in the cinema involved with fire. In application, Smith and Littlewoods, 1987, Volume 1, Appeal Court, page 241, illustrates that a lack of knowledge as to the events that took place on the part of Marjorie means that she could not have reasonably foreseen the events that took place, and it would be unreasonable to impose these duties upon Marjorie. For the reasons that have been submitted to the court, the respondents do not consider that Marjorie could have reasonably foreseen the events that took place, and thus the respondents request the appeal to be granted. It is for these submissions that the first round of appeal will be dismissed.
My leadership, my name is I am the junior counsel for the Pan-African Studies Day. I'd like to draw our leadership's attention to page 1 of our bundle to the development argument of my leadership aspect. Does my leadership, if it may please my leadership, I shall be our second round of appeal. Marjorie and Bartholomew had a special relationship as a mother and son, entitling Bartholomew to rely on affirmative actions by Marjorie, and as such, it would be fair, just, and reasonable to require Marjorie to demonstrate a duty of care to the said appellant or the reasonable parent judged by the standards of the day. I would like to submit the first authority. I'd like to draw my leadership's attention to the Caparo case. In G1 tab, which is the second last tab of the bundle. Does my leadership have say?
Okay.
Would my leadership like a brief summary of the It is submitted that for going reasons, a planning case satisfies the element of fair, just, and reasonable set out in the comparison. I'd like to draw my leadership's attention to this in the highlighted portion of the authority, whereby Lord Bingham held that it was foreseeable that a negligent misstatement in the auditor report referring to an annex account would cause economic loss to the investors. This landmark case, as set out in the authority, it submitted that for going reasons, a penalty clearly satisfied the element of fair, just, and reasonable set out in the comparator. This threefold test set not only this requirement, but the criteria of proximity was highly satisfied. It was clear that the element of fair, just, and reasonable to impose a duty of care to the parent was set forth. I'd like to draw my leadership's attention to my next authority in F1 tab of the bundle. Towards the end of the bundle, my leadership. This should be the next one. Towards the end, F1 tab.
What am I looking for?
You're looking for the authority of McFarlane versus State and Health Board. Excuse me, my leadership, G2, correction. Sorry.
I found it then.
Much obliged. May I direct your lordship to this authority of the bundle where my leadership is a few outside?
Indeed.
The case of McFarlane and State and Health Board. My leadership, would you like a summary of the fact of the case?
Yes.
Okay. The case involved parents whereby there was a criminal negligence bringing up a healthy child born as a result of the failure of a vasectomy operation, which the defendant had negligently carried out on the father. The court held that the parents of a healthy child could not recover damages for the cause of bringing up. In this regard, I'd like to bring my leadership's attention to the authority whereby it was held, as a matter of public policy, a healthy child should not be the basis of a wrong in which damages are recoverable. In this case, the defendant would reasonably also be able to foresee the damage suffered by the parent, and the degree of proximity is clear and set out prior to the comparison. Moreover, in the present case, it can be said to have satisfied this criteria, furthermore, by justifying issues of quality. In this regard, I would like to draw my leadership's attention to F1, tab F1 within the bundle.
Sorry, I'll stop here. Can you go back and explain about the policy in respect to this particular case at hand?
Indeed, my leadership. In regard to policy and also drawing my leadership attention back to Montpellier tab G2, as collected earlier. As a matter of public policy, a healthy child should not be the basis for the wrong for which the damages are recoverable. Back to the facts of the case, and reflected back on the issue of quality as requested by my leadership, the junior, there is fair and just reasonable cause for bringing an action against his mother for failing to protect the child. However, issues of policy occur whereby, in this exceptional circumstance where the child may have not only just had damage, but the damage was permanent damage. Therefore, issues of policy come about in this scenario whereby it must be considered by the court about the issues regarding policy. Much advice, my leadership. I'd like to now draw my leadership's attention back to the authority of March 30, Western State and Board Health Board in tab F1, which is the last tab of your bundle, whereby in the highlighted portion it was set out, and I quote, "In my opinion, it would not be just fair or reasonable in any assessment of the loss caused by the birth of the child to leave these benefits out of the account." I put it to the court that the case was one of duty of care, as set out clearly, whereby there was a high degree of proximity between the two parties, in the sense that they were pre-tort relationship involving elements of responsibility on the part of the defendant. In this regard, I'd like to conclude my argument. The junior counsel of the appellant that the court on the second round of appeal uphold the case. That concludes my submission for the appellant. Does my leadership require any further assistance?
No, thank you. Thank you. My lady, I am Jane Okun. I am junior counsel for the respondent, and I would be arguing on the grounds, the second ground, saying it would not be fair, just or reasonable to impose a duty of care to such an act of omission. May I please my lady? If my lady could turn to tab 4. Case 1063 AFLU. This is a case of home office and process. This case involved seven boys who had escaped and had gone to damage the ship of the sentence. And this thing was brought because the court wanted to prove that there was no possibility. And this act of omission was not, it was not fair, just unreasonable to hold the boys responsible. My lady, the appellant was not even at home. Marjorie was not at home at the time of the incident, because there was nothing she could have done. She could have been able to do, seeing that she was not given the range of the danger. She could not have been able to stop the harm from falling, but then when she got back, she thought it wise to call for an ambulance. Thus shows that she did try within her capacity to stop the harm from going further. May I proceed, my lady? If my lady would turn to tab 5, page 646, I said no. If my lady has that view. My lady, the judge, Judge Lovio Lopez, in his judgment in Goldman and Hargrave, explained that there may be a duty to act if the person is aware of the incident. My lady, Marjorie was not even aware of what was going on at the time of the incident. And from past events, there was no such history that Hunton would cut his son. So She wouldn't have been able to know that on this particular day things were going to be different. If there's anyone who was a victim of this physical and verbal abuses, she was the one. My testimony. On my second round, or on my second submission, Mary returned to tab 6, page 6 plus 7, highlighted in pink. In judge and delivered by Justice Jackson, he explains that Marjorie did not adopt or continue the harm and had not acted in a way which suggested furthering the harm already caused by conductance, and she should not be held liable.
Referring to what Mr. Justice Jackson held, which obviously that's not as important as what was done at the time level.
If my lady was unaffectionate, if my lady returned to tab 7, I like 17.
Yeah.
And the judgment is that by the view of the first, in the same state of Bowman Humphrey. He explains that the duty owed by a person who undertakes a specific activity which carries the risk of causing harm to another, but then this act of omission should not be, Marjorie should not be held liable for this act of omission because it's not objectively reasonable to prevent such harm. He should not undertake the activity at all if it's not possible to objectively prevent such harm. She did not cause the harm, but then she tried to prevent it from going further by calling the ambulance as soon as she was aware of the harm. The fact of parent who did not give rise to the duty of care to act in this particular situation, because it would not be fair just and reasonable to expect that Marjorie would have known that on that particular day Hamilton was going to harm Bartholomew, because it had never happened. So it was not such that would have been expected from a dad who always brought home dinner for himself and his son. In this present case, there is more to play in the circumstance of this case than merely a relationship of parent and child. Because if Hamilton had not been drunk and had not been angered by the fact that there was no dinner, this harm would not have happened. More so, one would not have expected him to be angered by the fact that there was no dinner, because he was always happy to bring home dinner every Thursday night, so he should not have expected his wife to have dinner, because, well, she would have thought that he was going to be happy to bring home dinner on this particular day. Although he used to come home drunk, there was no such trait or any event in the past that would have made Marjorie reasonably to foresee that on this particular day Hamilton was going to cause a failure. It is with this submission that the responding on to the grounds this means, unless I can help my lady.
Thank you.